Or no, I'll begin with facts first.
You see,
euthanasia, if you see by definition, is assisted killing. It can be voluntary, involuntary, it can be active and passive, it can be classified in various manners. But the fact remains that euthanasia deals with three core issues. One is chronic pain, to relieve chronic pain. Two is to relieve chronic suffering. And three is what we call as, in terms of terminally ill patients which have irreversible damage and they cannot be revived, or brain dead patients.
Understood.
Pain and suffering can never be classified, it can never be quantified. Now we are talking of a particular patient which was a nurse who was raped and strangulated and she was having hypoxic brain damage. But please understand, and I'll take 1 minute of your time, that there is a lot of patients we see clinically who have chronic pain right from birth. There are chromosomal disorders, there are structural abnormalities from birth, there are chronic patients with oncology and cancer diseases, there are road traffic accidents, and of course there is what we call as brain dead patients. Now, coming to the medical science, when you are focusing on pain or suffering, it can never be quantified. We cannot say this patient has to end the life because of certain medical conditions or not. Secondly is, when you talk in terms of brain dead or in the severe form of chronic vegetative state, please understand that in the last 10 years there have been tremendous amount of medical advances in which even people like Michael Schumacher, which was put in a hypothermic ventilatory state, has recovered after almost 6 months
yes.
of perhaps no recovery in any other part of the world.
Yes.
Yeah, just 1 minute, please. There are also patients who have begged for euthanasia or mercy killing, like a patient known as Sonali Mukherjee, who was a severe acid attack patient,
yes.
and in fact she was treated by us and she has recovered. So instead of saying dignity while dying, I will rather focus in saying let's give them dignity while living. I don't think as medical professionals we can pull the plug on any patient, knowing fully well that whatever best treatment we can give till the patient breathes last, that's our duty and
no,
that's
but
what
our state. No, one second. Now, I want a full response from Harish Salve on that. You see, we are a very selfish state, Mr. Salve. We don't take of our old and aging and our sick. And there has been a case, perhaps you're aware of it, of a 70-year-old retired school teacher from in Karnataka who stays in an old age home till 2003. She files a petition where she seeks physician-assisted death because she says, I cannot afford the cost of my medical treatment, right? Now, the court rejects the petition and directs NIMHANS to give free treatment to her for 4 weeks and submit a report. But with a change of the laws, unfortunately, there may be hundreds of thousands of people like this who will say that, you know, we are suffering, we are not taken care of, and we want to die. How many people will we then allow, Harish Salve, to go along that path?
Arnab, let's put them in three separate silos. Does the doctor have a right to pull the plug? Is a completely separate issue from do the relatives have the right to pull the plug? Is a completely separate issue from saying if I'm in a form of an illness which I know will head towards terminal illness. Do I have the right to say, if I reach a particular point, please do not prolong my agony? Do the doctors have a right to pull the plug on their own? Sanjeev's point is well taken. The Hippocrates Oath obliges them to keep people alive. The
yes.
state can never be heard to say we don't have resources to keep people alive. So that's one completely separate issue. Do the relatives have a right to say, I cannot afford to pay? That's a question mark issue.
How?
If somebody is brain dead and the relatives are being asked to pay, they may not pay, which pushes you back to the first issue. Does the state have to keep him alive? My answer is yes. I am talking of a very small circle, the right to live with dignity. Today, if I am in a terminal illness and at a state when I am capable of taking rational decisions, I have not lost my faculty of thinking. I say, I know I'm heading down this road. If I reach a particular point, please help me exit rather than prolong my existence. Is that not a right?
Okay, just a small point to that. Harish Salve, it is. No, no, one second. Harish Salve, Harish Salve, just a small interjection on that. As I said, sir, I underline, we are a very cruel country with our citizens.
Yes.
We have no health care. Yes. Sanjeev Bagai, you can come in, anyone can. We have no health care. We don't provide basic medical care. Now, everybody is not a Michael Schumacher, right? So Michael Schumacher was kept alive. We don't even let people live.
Yes.
I am saying today that self-assisted suicide, you know, what you call a person's decision euthanasia. To carry out passive euthanasia or I will not take medicines is not the issue that I want to be led to my death. Where will you, up panelists on the other side say you're opening a Pandora's box. Sanjeev Bagai wants to come back into that debate because...
Is an argument as a lawyer which we have heard. When we said if you go into judicial review, you'll open Pandora's box. If you allow Supreme Court to review contracts, you'll open Pandora's box.
No, no, sir.
We've opened that by itself is not an issue.
Sir, Sanjeev Bagai. Sanjeev Bagai is responding to you, Harish Salve.
My only argument is that a limited resource of healthcare or a topsy-turvy economy in which some people can afford private healthcare and some people cannot afford government healthcare for routine medicines does not define or cannot be a criteria to decide either by the relatives or by certain patients.
Yep.
Now, I'll open it to the two or three segments which you eliminated earlier. And you cannot eliminate them because they are overlapping. One is medical issues. Now, it's just not a chronic vegetative state. You're looking at pain and suffering from neurodegeneration. You're looking at dementia. You're looking at chromosomal and genetic disorders. You're looking at metabolic disorders. It's a host. It's a very, very large segment of patients.
My Anand Grover.
Where do we draw a line? Point number two is when you're talking in terms of a chronic vegetative state, I agree that everyone is not a F1 formula driver who can be saved. But the fact is there are advances in medical science which we call as deep brain stimulation. They are being done in India too, and patients do recover. So it is very difficult on clinical grounds, medical grounds, or legal or social grounds to have a given set of criteria which in a large country like India which we can follow. And lastly and most importantly,
Sanjeev, the point is
what Harish has said with regards use and abuse, it's impossible. In India we cannot eliminate quacks. How are we going to keep use?
That's another good point.
In inverted commas.
It's a good point. Sorry. It's a good
Nobody
point.
Gives we have you the right to pull the plug. The point is my will, if I am in a particular state, to say if the doctors give me no hope, I would rather exit with dignity.
Sir, I know your argument.
It's very different from saying if a doctor
I take your point. You are coming from a very basic point, Mr. Salve, and Anand, I'm coming to you, that if a person has a right to life, why shouldn't the person have a right to die with dignity? Isn't it a person's choice as to the degree of suffering that he or she can withstand instead of helplessly waiting for his or her death? I'm coming to you on the religious point as well. Anand Grover is responding to Sanjeev Bagai. Anand Grover, yes, please.
Sandeep, I can say only one thing. I agree with him that there can be enormous misuse in this country. So you have to have level of layers of decision making which take into account all that you've said. Those things have to be taken into consideration. You should not only have the relatives pulling the plug, you cannot only have doctors pulling the plug.
Yes,
so you have to have a layered
set
of checks and balances. One minute. But if you decide that a person has a right to live with dignity and die with dignity, you have to fulfill that purpose. And therefore, you have to have a number of layers for decision making. Now, the other point is, I don't think there's any difficulty. If a person has decided by a will or advanced instructions to say, I want to die in a particular state, vegetative state, then that's not really a big problem according to me in law. But when there are no advanced instructions and relatives come into the picture and they want to bump him off, then it's a very big problem. That's where we have to take the issue.
Okay, one second. Anand, I need to... I started with the religious argument.
Point.
I need to close with it. Because
or no, just one point.
Sanjeev, very briefly, please, because I need to go back. I need to go back to Abraham Mathai. Because my bigger point is that we need to decide this whole religious versus natural death argument. I needed to make a point on that.
I'm not keeping.
Yes, Sanjeev.
Yeah, I'm not keeping the religious overtones into my argument. My point is very straight. Even countries like Australia and Ireland and even Canada actually withdrew euthanasia by law, which they had in vogue because of the abuse problem.
Yeah.
There are just four very small and very close-knit societies in the EU, which include Luxembourg and Belgium and Switzerland and so on, which have limited use of euthanasia. There were 11 states in US who had euthanasia, and it's zeroed down only to Washington, Oregon, and Montana. Even there, it is restricted. So in limited population also, they have enormous problems of controlling its abuse. In India, it will be let loose. It will be wildfire.
I take your point. And in these societies, they do take care of their people. There is social security, etc. But I want to close by asking this point to Dr. Abraham Mathai. Dr. Mathai, you know, please don't take it otherwise. But in the 21st century, in the India of 2014, morality and religion, even in the matter of dying, cannot be the sole guiding force for law. The interest of the people has to be, the constitution has to be. You can't bring religion as the guiding force for lawmaking in India of 2014, Abraham Mathai. There are some areas where religion cannot be allowed. Maybe this is one of them, Abraham Mathai.
Arnav, I'll tell you, this passive euthanasia is a physician-assisted suicide, but it's a suicide. So if suicide is an offense, this also is an offense. And you're actually usurping God's authority over man's life. And as one of the participants said, that ours is a poor country and the poor families, they will try to eliminate their relatives. It's definitely going to happen, and we are going to actually open a Pandora's box. Here in a country where even kidneys and vital organs get robbed by doctors, one can really imagine if this is actually legalized, what we are going to face.
Well,
I said earlier, there will be so many kind of advocacy groups. People who are lame, people who are mentally challenged, people who are blind. They all want to say that we want to die because we want to live with dignity. So the words you said, live with dignity, is it's a very debatable issue.
I understand.
And this should not be permitted.
I understand. You know, the only argument is that when people are in an irreversible vegetative condition, when no meaningful life is possible, then it can be allowed. But however, this is a complex debate. I'm just happy we are presenting different points of view tonight, taking into view different perspectives, not taking a position on this. The debate on dying with dignity, an important one, needs to be carried forward. I thank our participants for joining me on debate number 2 on the News Hour tonight.